Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Apologies have been received from the convener, Finlay Carson, MSP, and we welcome Edward Mountain as a substitute. We also welcome Emma Harper, MSP, for part of the meeting when Jim Fairley has to leave for approximately 90 minutes.
Yeah, my apologies to the rest of the committee and to the panel. I will be gone for about 90 minutes, but I do intend to return and be brought up to date at the end. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. Before we begin, can I remind those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent? Agenda item one, our first item of business today is to decide whether to take item five in private. Are members agreed? If participating remotely, please type N into the chat box if you do not agree. Otherwise, I will presume members are content. Moving on to our second item of business this morning, it's an evidence session on the Islands Act annual report. I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting Marie Goujon, Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands. I also welcome her officials, Erica Clarkson, Head of Islands Policy and Communities, Nicola Crook, National Islands Plan Team Leader, Professor Francesco Sindico, Carbon Neutral Islands Team Leader, Scottish Government, and Phil Raines. Could I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make opening remarks?
Okay, thank you, Convener. And I really just wanted to start today by saying a few words about the Scottish Government's second annual report on our delivery of the National Islands Plan for 2021. The report outlines where progress has been made towards each specific commitment within the National Islands Plan, and it details our projects and resource spend where that's appropriate. But first, I really just want to acknowledge the support that we've received from stakeholders over the course of the past year. We've benefited from really vital collaboration with local authorities, with island stakeholders and communities themselves. Now, we've lived and continue to live through really challenging times. And approximately 12 weeks after we'd launched the National Islands Plan, the country entered lockdown. And like so many other communities across Scotland, our islands faced unprecedented challenges. Islanders experienced issues with supply chains, with transport and access to services. COVID-19 has had a deep and lasting impact on the health, well-being and finances of many islanders, and we continue to work exceptionally hard to support them in the best way that we can. But now that we're slowly moving out of the COVID-19 pandemic, the stark rise in energy prices and the associated negative effects on the cost of living is creating a new set of challenges. Islands already face some of the highest levels of fuel poverty, which are being further impacted by the current energy crisis. And despite these challenging times, though, the National Islands Plan continues to provide Scottish Government with a real opportunity and a focus to improve the lives of people on islands. And as you'll see in the annual report, I'm really pleased to see good progress across the National Islands Plan 13 strategic objectives. I don't have time to detail all the work that's been done on every single one of those objectives and commitments, but I just want to share with the committee a few of the highlights from the report. Firstly, we've launched a number of funding streams that have enabled island communities not only to better cope through COVID-19, but also develop innovative and transformational projects. And second, we're developing the Islands Bond, and that will play a role in tackling depopulation and promoting sustainable economic development on our islands. Third, we've launched the Carbon Neutral Islands project that will support six islands in their efforts to reach net zero by 2040. And these islands will become climate trailblazers for all other Scottish islands too. And fourth, we're also continuing to work with Kerrera and Fair Isle on two major projects which are transforming both islands in a really positive way. And I'll be happy to touch on other projects and activities in answering the committee's questions. But I hope that some of these examples give you a bit of a flavour of the range and breadth of work that we've done in relation to the National Islands Plan. To conclude, the cost of living, child poverty, depopulation and the climate are just some of the critical areas that islands face. Scottish Government takes all of these seriously, and together with my colleagues across other portfolios, we'll spare no effort in tackling them decisively. Delivery of the National Islands Plan is a journey, and while we still have a way to go, it's also an opportunity to provide support and capacity to islands so that they can emerge from these challenging times as resilient and ultimately more sustainable communities. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And Could you indicate what does the annual report actually say about the overall progress towards meeting the 13 strategic objectives, and how, you know, what extent it's already met population decline and transport services? You've already referenced fuel poverty, and you'll not be surprised I'm interested in transport services.
Yes, absolutely. Well, I think what you can see from the annual report when you go through it in terms of all the commitments that we've set out, we also set out where we are in relation to those commitments. There are a number of commitments within the report which have been completed, but there are also a number of other commitments where work is ongoing, where they're not immediate actions that we can take to solve some of these problems. A lot of these issues have been ongoing for a long time, and others we are working very hard to resolve as well. So, for example, in relation to some of the areas that you touched on there, whether that's in relation to transport and some of the other projects we've been working on, in my opening comments, I touched on the Isle of Kerrera project and the work that's been taking place there. So through our Islands Infrastructure Fund, we awarded over £500,000 really to connect the length of the island, and we know that's something that will have a tangible impact and will be very visible too. I also touched on one of the projects in relation to the Fair Isle and the Bird Observatory, where we'd also invested in that through the same programme too, again, which will have a positive impact on the island itself as well as the wider islands. So I think these are some of the tangible things that we can see. But again, there are huge pieces of work that are still underway, but where we are continuing to make good progress. So you touched on transport, there's population, where there's a pile of work that's underway at the moment too. I touched briefly on the Islands Bond, so work has been underway at pace on that. There's been extensive community engagement in relation to that so that we can develop a proposal which will work for our islands and for our island communities too. So I don't know if officials would want to touch a bit further on that project, if the committee would be interested in hearing a bit more in relation to where we are with the Islands Bond. And again, the Islands Bond itself is not something that we will solve depopulation on our islands. We know that there are many complex and different reasons responsible for this, so it's not seen as a silver bullet that will resolve the issues that we face, but it's certainly something that we believe can help if it's used in the right way. But again, I'll hand over to officials if there's any further information.
Would the committee like some more information about the Islands Bond?
Well, I think we're kind of, if there's so many questions that everybody wants to ask. If that comes up again, then
of course,
in the questions that, from other members, then we can pick up on it then. Thank you. Could I ask about the Islands Connectivity Plan, which is going to replace the Ferries Plan by the end of 2022? Orkney and Shetland's internal ferry services are excluded from the Islands Connectivity Plan. So I wonder if you could explain the reason for excluding the Northern Isles in the plan and what can be done to provide communities with the lifeline ferry services they desperately need.
Yes, the plan is due to be to the successor to the Ferries Plan, and I know that progress on that had been delayed because of the pandemic, but it will be progressing this year, and I believe a draft of the plan will be ready for consultation by the end of this year, and that's certainly the aim of that. In relation to the connectivity plan itself and the specific detail that you've talked about there, I don't know if officials would have further information in relation to the issue that you've just raised there.
I think we may need to take some of this back to our transport colleagues and write back to committee with some responses in terms of that data, but we are working closely with our Transport Scotland colleagues on the development of the Islands Connectivity Plan and listening very carefully to communities as we support that work, and I know that they are being careful to give regard to aviation and to ferries and fixed links as well as connections and onward travel once folk have got off the islands.
Thank you. Can I now invite Alistair Allen for his questions?
Thank you, Convener. One of the strategic objectives that you and I think the Convener, Cabinet Secretary and the Convener have touched on there is fuel poverty and the work the government the Scottish Government is doing around that. Can I ask how the work that the Scottish Government does on that relates to what's happening in the reserved sphere? Obviously, it's difficult to talk about fuel poverty without talking about transmission charges. For instance, if we're talking about renewables as part of the answer in the islands, it's difficult to overlook, is it not, the fact that energy companies in Scotland have to pay 7.36 per megawatt to connect to the national grid compared to most other countries around Europe where projects have to pay virtually nothing?
Yes, you're absolutely right. There are undoubtedly challenges there. And of course, in relation to that, that's an area that's reserved to the UK government too. So again, we continually try to engage and are engaging with Ofgem to raise these very significant issues in relation to that, because there are these extra, essentially penalties that we face in Scotland. But again, these are issues that we do continue to raise with Ofgem and with the UK government.
And briefly related to that, again, how do the strategic objectives around fuel poverty that you're working on in an island context, how do they relate to recent events around fuel price hike? And this is I'm sure other people representing islands here are more than aware of this as well, but certainly I'm very aware of the fact that heating oil, which is still the main source of heating in off-gas grid areas, seems to be accelerating in price even beyond the dizzy heights of other forms of fuel. So how do you adjust policies as you go around these strategic objectives to make sure you take account of what's happening at the UK level on that?
Well, I think that's a really important point, because I think it is something that we have to continue to monitor, because I think even since publishing this plan, things have escalated since then, and we have seen things get continually worse. So I think that's where the monitoring of the plan itself and the objectives that we have and the commitments that we've set out is really important. The route map is also an important part of this process too, which we will be looking to publish shortly, because that will set out in more detail the actions that will be taking to meet the commitments that have been set out within the plan. But again, this is something we do have regular communications with. We have a couple of different forums. We have the National Islands Plan Delivery Group. Again, they'd be meeting quarterly to look at the route map, and we're in constant discussions with them. That's made up of our local authorities, with other third sector community representatives as well. We also have the Island Strategic Forum too, where we engage with local authorities and their chief executives, again, to talk about essentially how we can work together to try and address these challenges as they emerge. And it's through that regular engagement we can try and identify the issues that are emerging and hopefully try and address them. We also do have a number of different strategies. We had obviously passed the Fuel Poverty Act a couple of years ago. We have the Fuel Poverty Strategy as well, a variety of different funds that we have in place to really try and help those who are experiencing the worst of fuel poverty. But there is no doubt that it's our people living on our islands and our island communities who are feeling the pressure of this acutely. So it's important that we do everything we can and working across government to try and tackle some of these issues.
Thank you.
Thank you. Questions now from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In the annual report, it mentions one of the objectives is to work with policy colleagues to produce a national development plan for crofting, which will set the long-term strategic direction for crofting and ensure that there are plenty of new entrants in rural and remote communities. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary when the Cabinet will decide to bring forward crofting reform and how that will ensure a healthy turnover of crofting tenancies on our islands to create those opportunities for new entrants?
Yes, unfortunately, I can't give the committee a definitive date on when we would be bringing forward legislation. I mean, ultimately, that will be up to the Parliament to decide as well when that comes forward. But it is something that we've committed to doing, because we know that there are issues that we need to address that had been raised through the previous parliamentary session. So we are currently looking to work on that and to introduce legislation at some point. But in terms of definitive dates for that and to try and address some of these issues, I can't give the committee that at the moment.
Okay. Also in the annual report, another of the objectives is working with the Crofting Commission again to encourage that healthy turnover of crofting tenancies, mm-hmm. Again to create the demand for new entrants. But the Croft House grant has only given out half of the actual budget between 16 and 17 and 2021. It was 11 million. It's, as you know, it's only distributed 6 million. Is there a reason for that?
I mean, it's ultimately up to the demand in terms of the number of applications that we get to the Croft House grant scheme too. But of course, it's something, it's a fund that we've committed to maintaining and supporting, because we do recognise that it's critical in helping to sustain our crofting communities too.
Can I seek clarity as to whether the islands bond will be used for young people to access crofting?
Again, we've been undertaking detailed engagement on the islands bond. We wouldn't want that to duplicate or cut across other initiatives that we have in government. It wouldn't make sense for that to happen. But I'll be happy to hand over to Erica to provide more information on that.
Thank you. So we have actually been speaking to quite a lot of crofters through the Islands Bond consultation, and it's becoming apparent through those discussions that we do need to look a little bit deeper about how the bond might be able to support them with some of the more some of the smaller costs, like applications. I'm not very familiar with crofting policy, I'm afraid, but certainly we've been speaking with lots of crofters, and I think now through the bond we're looking at ways we can work with the Commission to perhaps enhance what they do with that in some way.
Okay, I was specifically looking for detail because clearly crofters can't get a mortgage. So therefore, will the Islands Bond allow them to seek finance options for purchasing a croft?
At the moment, through the consultation process, we're just now starting to analyse the responses that we've had and to set out the criteria for applying for the bond. So we don't have that answer right now.
Okay, thank you.
I have a supplementary from Alistair Allen.
I just wondered if you maybe on that one say any more about how many crofters have been helped either through this route or through other routes like the Croft House Grant Scheme, or whether that's on the increase.
In terms, I'd be happy to get back to the committee with further information as to the amount that we've been funding through the Croft House Grant Scheme and how many people we've assisted through that scheme as well, if that would be helpful.
Questions now from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary and the panel. I have the privilege of representing Argyll and Bute, so lots of amazing islands, and visiting them, you referenced Kerrera Road, it's made a huge difference. And the island communities are working together to find different solutions to each of their problems, for example, in housing, renewables, community land ownership, asset ownership. And many of these fall under different ministerial portfolios, so I'm interested to hear how you work with your colleagues to ensure the island specifics are included in all policy areas.
Yes, and as you can see from the strategic objectives that we have set out in the plan as well, it touches almost every other part of government. So that's where it is really important in relation to my role in government, how I engage with my colleagues to ensure that islands and for our rural areas as well, that these considerations are taken into account when forming policy. But it's also where island community impact assessments are really important as well, as part of the landmark legislation that was introduced a few years ago. And it's they're obviously an obligation that must be undertaken, so I think that they're critical in that process too. But I do also engage with my ministerial colleagues in relation to some of the cross-cutting issues that we have. And I think another example of that as well, I touched on in a previous response in relation to some of the different groups that we have for that continuous engagement. One is the Islands Strategic Forum with local authorities, where we'll often have another minister there as well from the relevant policy area to discuss these issues with local authorities and with chief executives too, because I think it's important to have that cross-portfolio working, so whether that's in transport, health, housing. We've had a variety of different meetings along to ministers along to previous meetings, and I think that engagement is really critical. But I do see that as a vital part of my role in government, is ensuring that there is that islands considerations are issues relating to islands are a consideration across other portfolios.
Thank you very much. You referenced in your introduction the impact of COVID-19 on island communities, and I think, yes, like all of Scotland, the rest of the world, we've had negative impacts, but I also think there have been really important learnings about how islands recognise their own resilience. And in fact, last week I was at a Community Land Scotland event which was looking at how asset management, asset ownership actually helped communities pull together and find solutions. So that's really positive. However, on the kind of the flip side of that, when I'm visiting islands, I often hear concerns that perhaps other stakeholders that are incorporated into the way that islands operate perhaps put up barriers to stop that innovative ideas coming from islanders. So I'm interested to know what the Scottish Government's able to do and also the islands team are able to do to help reduce this.
Absolutely. I think it's that working with other bodies is absolutely critical to try and overcoming some of these issues. And in terms of the objectives and the commitments that we've set out, it's just simply not possible for us to deliver them on our own or in isolation, and nor would we want to. I think it's really important that we work with other, whether that's public bodies, with our local authorities, to try and overcome a lot of these issues too. And I think in relation to the impact of COVID-19 that you touched on as well, we'd also had research that have been undertaken by GHI in relation to that to look at the impact. And I think, there were many challenges that had been identified through part of that. But I think, you know, one of the strengths was seen exactly what you've highlighted there in terms of the resilience and the strong community bonds that are there too. So I don't know if officials would have anything else to add either in relation to that work on GHI. Is it Francesco?
I'm happy just to say a few words on how the team can help to produce innovation and how to work together with the island communities. As you just mentioned, and Argyll and Bute is just one of them, obviously, the amount of innovation, the amount of resilience that COVID-19 has highlighted has just been absolutely outstanding. And the way we see it, and I obviously can talk more on behalf of the Carbon Neutral Island Project, is that it's very much a question of working with the communities. And now that the pandemic is slowing down and everything, we'll finally have also the opportunity to go back to the islands and to listen a lot. There needs to be a lot of learning and listening. The world has changed to some extent. And it's an opportunity through the project, through the bond, through so many other activities that we do, to go back to the islands and reestablish that relationship that is really the foundation of what can then take the islands forward, any community, but in particular the islands, because of the work we do. And one thing just to stress again what Cabinet Secretary said, the nature of the work we do is collaborative, both within the islands but also in this building. And not just at Cabinet Secretary level, but I just want to emphasize that also at officials level, we work very closely with our colleagues in government. And that's the only way that these strategic objectives will ever be done, because we don't have the magic bullet. We don't have the silver bullet. So just to emphasize that and to reassure that we work very closely, again, to give you one example, there's a climate change-wide committee, a climate change-wide group within government, and we are part of that, and we bring the island voice, and they hear us, and we have developed those relationships. And a lot of this is about these relationships. Obviously, you need more than just a relationship, I know that, but it is an incredibly important foundation. I'll leave it to that, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. Can I move on to questions from Ariane, please?
Thank you, Convener. And thank you so much for that last contribution. I didn't catch your name because I'm attending remotely. And apologies to everyone for attending remotely. So I'm going to continue with the theme on improved outcomes during years one and two. So the additionals power request established a power for island local authorities to request devolution of specific functions, duties or responsibilities. And this was intended to be a key mechanism to empower island councils and communities. And yet I've not heard of it being used. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary if you're aware of it being used, or if there are any barriers which are inhibiting local authorities making use of this power?
No, the power hasn't been used so far. In relation to any potential barriers that would be inhibiting local authorities from using that power, I'm certainly not aware from the conversations I've had that there are particular issues there, unless officials have anything further to add on that point.
No, thank you for the question. I can confirm we've had no requests from any of our local authority partners for additional powers as yet, but we would welcome such a request. From a policy perspective, it would be quite exciting to take that forward.
And work constructively through that process too.
Thanks very much. Do you think that the island councils are fully aware of it in all the busyness of the work of their day-to-day work? Do you think that they've really taken it on board, that they've been given this power?
I think so. Again, it's not something that I've had particularly. It's not an issue that I've been made aware exists at the moment. I would presume the island authorities, given by their very nature and through the Islands Act itself, that they would be aware that that power exists. I would like to think so anyway, but again, not aware of any potential barriers that they perceive are there in relation to using that power.
Thanks for that response. I'm going to move on to another theme, which is around addressing population decline. It's encouraging to hear about the measures like repopulation zones, which aim to increase island populations, but I'm aware that not all population growth is equal, given that growth in older demographics can inflate house prices and crowd out young people. If the government will roll out national repopulation zones, will they allow for a nuanced approach, such as focusing efforts on increasing population amongst the 18 to 40-year-olds and taking measures in line with achieving this more specific goal?
I think that's where there is so much work that's going on in this area. You know, we've talked a bit about the island bond and how that might complement some of the other measures that we're looking at in relation to that too. But also through the Convention of the Highlands and Islands, we have a population working group on that as well. And that's working with the Scottish Government, with third sector too. Because again, you know, Francesco talked about collaboration and how important that is. And I think particularly when we're dealing with issues like this, that's where that collaboration is absolutely critical. Now, we also in government have an expert group on population and migration, and I know that they've been, I think they had their been reconvened in March, and this is part of the work that they're looking at and is in relation to zonal methodologies, and they've been commissioned to look at that to really kind of scope that out, what boundaries might be, how it could be implemented, how it could be monitored. But I think it's important that we look at that too. But I would also, so I don't know if officials would want to touch on the work of that working group. And just before I hand over in relation to that point too, I think it's also important to highlight just some of the other initiatives that we're working on. There's obviously we have a ministerial task force on population, which is due to meet this month, where we work across government in considering all these issues too. We'd have also announced that we would be taking forward a rural visa pilot scheme. Now, this is something which had been agreed by Sajid Javid when he was Home Secretary at that time, based on the recommendations of the Migration Advisory Committee. And because I do think that there are a number of different, we see this happen in countries all over the world, where there are different methods and means used in relation to migration. So that's where we've established a working group to really start to try and develop pilot proposals for that as well. Because I do think that, you know, the reasons behind depopulation are so multifaceted and complex. We need to make sure that we get to grips with all that data, but also that we try these different initiatives to find a solution that's going to work for rural communities in Scotland. But I'll hand over to officials if they'd have anything else to add.
The only thing I would probably add is just to pick up on that work that that ministerial task force, which is on population, which is being led by the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And a lot of the work that we're involved in, working with our colleagues who lead on that population program work, is, I guess in essence, is because it's such a multifaceted issue, because it's less about any one particular policy area or investment. It's about how you bring all these things together, how you sequence them for the needs of a particular place, that we are giving a lot of serious thought to how do you make very real that idea of a place-based approach. How do you take all these different initiatives, which are often national, which are sometimes regional-wide, but actually bring them together in a way that addresses whatever the population needs are of a particular place. That's not always as easy as it sounds, but we are working closely with colleagues. We'll be working closely with COHI colleagues about how we can take that forward in a very real way under the umbrella of that population work. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those responses. I think one of the things that comes to me when I travel in the islands is, of course, the affordable housing issue, and a piece that I'm beginning to discover, because there's so many aspects to that, I think, as we have said many times, is that I'm encountering older people who are living maybe in homes that are too big for them. They want to downsize, but they don't want to leave their communities. So I think there's a piece in that mix, and I just wonder what your thoughts are, where we could look at, you know, we're going to, through MPF4, we're going to be having housing allocation, you know, across Scotland, but in the islands as well. If we could look at how doing housing differently, and I think we've discussed again also during MPF4 the evidence sessions in the past, the idea of clustered housing or clacken housing. And I do get a sense that older people, they want to downsize, but they don't want to leave their communities, and they're also feeling very isolated. And I wonder if there's an opportunity for looking at a different model. And I think, to pick up, Phil, your point you just made there about the placemaking, it's kind of like clustered housing with shared community facilities could really push us in that good direction, and it could potentially free up housing that's bigger for younger people to, you know, move in, and if they want to start families and that kind of thing. I just, Cabinet Secretary, I wonder what your thoughts are on that.
Absolutely open to looking at that and considering that, and obviously want to listen to island communities as we look to develop proposals, because one of the key commitments that we have to is to develop a remote rural and islands housing action plan. So I can't give a definitive date for when that's going to be published yet, and that's led by my Cabinet colleague Shona Robison. But I think that will be critical in trying to address some of these issues, because I think no matter where I go as well, I know that you're just talking about travel around the islands, and I think undoubtedly whenever I'm out in our rural communities and our island communities, housing is raised as a critical issue in terms of the ability to retain young working age people in a community too. And for example, we know that there are, it's not always a case of there's a lack of jobs, we know that can be job opportunities, but it's the ability to house people which is frequently raised as a critical issue. So I think I believe that the engagement work in relation to the action plan has commenced, but I'd be more than happy to feed that information back to ensure that that's part of the process too. But I know that there will be extensive engagement with our island communities too, so that they can be a part of that process.
Thanks very much for your thoughts on that. Convener, that's me for now. I'd like to come back in later on another theme.
Thanks, Ari. And before I move on to Jenny, just in terms of population decline, we know how complex it is, and obviously better transport links can help stop the outward flow. In terms of fixed links or tunnels, and we've seen what they can do in the likes of the Faroe Islands, where there's evidence of increased populations that's brought people out from the centre. I just wondered what the Cabinet Secretary's view is. Do you see that as a policy change that could help stop island depopulation?
Well, I know that I think this is actually issues related to that have been considered through the Strategic Transport Projects Review, and there'd been the consultation on that which closed last month. And I think that as part of the work that had been done in that and the proposals there, there had been proposals for fixed links. I think that was at the Sounds of Barra in Harris. And I think that there's been extensive engagement in relation to the development of these proposals too. So I think they form part of that. I don't know if officials would have anything further to add on that point, but I'd be happy to get back to the committee with further information. Oh, sorry, Francesco.
I just have a quick comment on the Faro experience. We tend to think that the fixed links and the depopulation is completely interconnected in the Faro Islands. I'm not saying it isn't, but the picture in the Faro Islands is much more complex than that. And the reasons for depopulation are related to, it's a bit like the National Islands Plan, all the strategic objectives, not just one. And also what you see in the Faro Islands has been a historical development that relates to Denmark, the governance and everything. So I do think we have a lot to learn from the Faro Islands and other islands and countries in Northern Europe. But we also have to be very careful to understand that what works in Denmark, what works in Norway, what works in the Faroe Islands, in Iceland, also has to do with their governance, with their setting and with so many other things. But again, let me reassure you from particularly the project that I am leading on, that we are having a very close look to the likes of the Faroe Islands and other islands, because although we have a lot that is going on very well on our islands, innovation, as we were saying, resilience, that we can share, there's always a lot that we can learn from, in particular from the Faroe Islands.
Absolutely agree. We can always learn lessons, and no point in reinventing the wheel. Jenny, question from you.
Thank you, Convener. I feel I'm going to give you a kind of a road trip round the islands in my constituency. I was on Jura on Friday, and it is experiencing population growth and also attracting younger populations as well. And quite rightly, the Development Trust and also the Community Council are incredibly proud of the work that they've been doing. However, they raise concerns about volunteer fatigue, who's going to take the island on to the next stage. I'd like to get your views and thoughts on how, you know, islands are not the same, each have got their own unique character. So how is the work focusing on the differences across the islands as well? And I suppose we can also talk about learning from other islands too, as well as in our own community.
Absolutely. You're right. And well, first of all, it's just really interesting and actually quite exciting to hear about the work that's happening on Jura as well. And I'd be interested to find out more about that. But I completely understand the points that you've made as well. I think particularly in small communities, the volunteer fatigue and a lot of people doing a lot of the same work too. And I think if there's anything that we can do to try and help support in that and support the initiatives that are underway there, then more than happy to take that away and look at it to see how we can support communities, because I think that is a really exciting development that you've outlined.
And really following on from some of the questions as well that Ariane was asking about housing, and this was raised as well when I was on Jura. I mean, I know you visited Colonsay and the fantastic partnership that exists there between the community, the Scottish Government and the business, the salmon business. One of the suggestions that was raised on Jura was looking at how to raise the funds as well and community share ownership or wider share ownership of housing. So there are lots of innovative ideas, and I'm really pleased to hear that you're hoping to get out and listen. And I would hope that the listening is the short part and the action is the big part. But I'd be interested to know just how you're planning to move ideas in these kind of areas suggested by communities forward.
Absolutely. I think it's vital that we capture that innovation and listen to these ideas. And if there's a different way that we can make things work, then I think it's really important that we consider that as well. And it was brilliant to visit Colonsay and to actually see the impact of a project like that, because as I touched on in a previous response, I think, you know, it's not for lack of employment there. You know, there's I think it was Maui who were investing in the homes there, and that partnership between the three bodies was really critical, and the housing there was really transformative, because I think that was one thing that really hit home listening to the community there, was just that, you know, you'd had somebody who spoke passionately there about having, you know, her family had lived on Colonsay for generations, but yet she was living in a caravan because the majority of homes were either second homes, and, you know, shutting young people out of accommodation when there are ample job opportunities available too. So I think that was a really exciting initiative, and I think wherever we can do that, work with communities, work with businesses as well, and I know that more are looking at that and what they can do to help with to deliver affordable housing is really important. And I would just come back to, I want to make sure that we are capturing that innovation and different ideas and really listening to communities as to what's going to work and can be delivered there.
Okay. We have a supplementary from Emma Harper, then we'll move on to questions from Alistair.
Thanks, Convener. Just waiting on my microphone being unmuted. Just a quick supplementary. There's a comprehensive document around the islands of the European Union, and it talks about the state of play and future challenges. So I'm wondering, Cabinet Secretary, how do we work with our European neighbours now when we're not in the EU, when there's some comprehensive planning and work that has been taken forward to look at equivalent issues.
Lost the link.
I think we've got half of it. Yeah, if you want me to jump in and answer anyway. I mean, I do think, obviously, now that we're out of the EU, the nature of that engagement is that bit more difficult. We're not members. We don't have exactly the same connections or involvement that, of course, we would have liked to have had and to maintain. But of course, we still look to closely engage with our European neighbours and to engage, as particularly when there are issues like this that do affect us all. And I know that there will be similar challenges in other parts of the EU too. And again, just like we've talked about in previous responses, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. I think it's important to look at what's happening elsewhere and engaging with our European counterparts on that. I mean, as an example of that, I mean, at COP26, it was a great forum to. I took part in an islands event and engaging with my equivalent ministers and other administrations in Europe and further afield to talk about similar challenges that we face and how we can look to address those. So I think that continuing engagement is really important to see what learnings we can essentially take from each other.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah, Francesco would like to come in.
Yes, thanks for this question. I just want to stress that although Brexit happened and the EU is not as close as it once before, it's still possible to make those partnerships. And partnerships and collaboration with European islands, with policymakers on European islands, with other stakeholders on European islands and beyond is something that the team is developing. Again, obviously I can speak more on the climate side, but islands are at the forefront of the climate struggle and climate action across Europe. And through the Carbon Neutral Island Project, we are, again, not just wanting to share good practices and receive that learning, but also lay a platform for Scottish companies, industry, also universities, R&D, to continue collaborating with our European partners. And it's true that some funding streams have made either are not there anymore or not as conspicuous as before, but others are still there. And it's a question of mapping what we can still tap into. And again, just to highlight, the island dimension, there's so much that we can learn, not just from Europe, but from all around the world. And there are organizations like GLISPA, like the UN Sustainable Development Goals Islands Hub, where we are present. We are a very strong voice there. Because let's remember that in Europe, there are only two countries that have an act, that have a plan. It's us and Croatia. Now, that doesn't mean we're better than any other, obviously not. But it does mean that we have a story. And in implementing that story, those partners are actually looking at us and want to know what we're doing. So, okay, we're not part of the European Union formally, but actually from an island dimension, we're very much at the heart of it.
Thank you for that. Alistair?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if I could turn briefly to the island survey which was conducted, and I'm going to return to the familiar theme here of housing, but one of the things that came out of that seemed to be younger people expressing the complications that they experienced in coming back to an island after being away for education or work elsewhere. I wonder if you could say a bit more about how you feel that the government can respond to that problem, given that, as we've heard, many islands face a labour shortage.
Yeah, and it's obviously disappointing to hear that come out of the survey, and we obviously want to encourage people to return and young islanders to come and return and live and work in our island communities too. And we know that again that we encounter a few different issues that also come out of that survey. You know, have an ageing population, we have younger people moving away and not returning, and younger working age people too. So it's important that we do what we can to try and address a lot of these. I know that there are various initiatives underway in relation to looking at student retention. We have to try and tackle some of these issues about, you know, around housing. We know that that's a problem for people, the lack of affordable housing too, but also connectivity, whether that's transport, whether that's digital connectivity too, making it as easy as possible for people to want to come to work and live and continue to stay in our island communities. So it's important that we really try and address a lot of these multifaceted issues.
You mentioned the housing and the work that's happening there. Obviously, there's a lot of money going into social rented housing in the island communities just now. I wonder what you feel that the government's plans can do to try and draw people together across different sectors to make that exercise work to the maximum. Obviously, we've got money going into social housing just now. What more do you feel can be done to listen to the needs of business, though, in all this? Because I think one of the themes coming through is that we need to plan that housing around the future needs of business and the future population, not just the people on the housing waiting list just now. So how do we work together across sectors to make sure that kind of stuff happens?
I think that's really important, and I think touching on the example that Jenny Minto had raised as well, because that's where industry have actually been a critical part of solving some of these problems too. So I think it's they need to be part of that conversation, and certainly I would hope through the Remote Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan that engagement will be taking place, because we've got to make sure that we're doing this and we're doing this in the right way and ensuring that we have that collaboration.
Do you feel that there are opportunities outside what might be considered traditional solutions to this? I mean, there's plenty of empty houses as well that have been talked about. I mean, what can we do to make sure that we work, as I say, in a flexible way across sectors that, for instance, brings empty houses back into use? And what can we do to make sure that those empty houses come back into use in an affordable way?
Yeah. And I think that's where our planning policy is obviously important to that as well, in terms of what that would be encouraging. Obviously, we've had the session on NPF4, where there is the focus on that, and a real focus on looking at vacant and derelict properties and trying to bring those back into use. So it's making sure that we knit these different strategies together, and again, that we are working collaboratively to ensure that we're delivering and providing affordable houses where they're needed by communities, and also suiting the needs of businesses both now and into the future too.
And finally, Convener, on this theme, again, looking at the issues that were raised in the survey about housing and so forth, you mentioned yourself that the situation is very different from island to island. How does the government intend to try and make sure that its response is tailored to those situations? Obviously, some, without going into all the examples I could quote here, obviously some islands have an oil industry, some islands have a fishing industry, some islands have a situation where they've got a shortage of housing. How do you make sure that an island's policy is tailored to those realities?
You're absolutely right. I mean, every island is different with its own unique set of challenges. And I think, probably touching on a previous response too, it's in relation to the data that we get as part of that, really trying to tease out the detail to understand the different issues for particular communities. And I think some of these issues were drawn out as well through the engagement that has been taking place through the Islands Bond. I mean, some people would prefer to see that mechanism work in a way that retains population. Others would like to see that in a way that attracts people to come and live in particular communities too. So again, that's where our engagement, how we engage with island communities, is really important, so that we get that understanding, and so that in developing policies we're doing it in a way that is flexible and is going to work for individual communities, because we're dealing in a situation with islands policy, it's not going to be one size fits all, and it's that collaboration, that engagement, that is really critical going forward.
Thank you.
Can I move on to questions from Karen Adam, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel and Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to ask, in the context of Brexit, really, we've just heard how, you know, the islands are quite, you know, they're individual, they all have their own unique positives and challenges. With island communities being so dependent on tourism, fisheries and agriculture, we're seeing a lot of labour shortages due to Brexit at the moment. How has that impacted upon these island sectors, and does that have anything to do with impact upon population decline?
I think undoubtedly it's had a massive impact, probably I think in all the areas that reside within my portfolio. So I see that firsthand and hear that, particularly in my engagement with different communities and with different businesses as well, because as you've outlined, a lot of the industries that we see on our islands are the ones that have been, you know, most adversely affected, which means that it does probably disproportionately affect our islands more so than many others, particularly right across. You know, you mentioned tourism, for example, for that well, particularly saw impacts through. There was the added impacts of COVID through that too. But in relation to labour shortages right across the piece, whether that's tourism, right through our food and drink businesses, where they have really struggled and they're continuing to struggle with some critical labour shortages in a lot of areas. Down to, of course, we've lost the free movement of people, but also now with the additional barriers to business of trading with the EU, which has become a lot more difficult for people with the added layers of bureaucracy, the extra costs that they've had to incur as a result of that too. So that's undoubtedly had a huge impact right across the food and drink industries, which there are a lot of in our rural and island communities too.
Thank you. And of course, we're just discussing housing as well. How does that impact housing, you know, sourcing materials and cost of materials? Has that affected the house building?
Yeah, we know that, particularly, I think we've been seeing the escalating costs for a while, and that's only getting worse rather than getting better. And we know that, again, that's something that does have a disproportionate impact on our island communities too, because there's the extra transport costs in terms of getting materials to islands before projects can even begin. So there's already that extra financial burden that they have to face, as opposed to in other areas in the mainland too. So, we do see the problem of increased costs.
Thank you.
I've got a brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton, and then we'll bring in Ariane Burgess.
It's just on the back of what Karen was saying. Obviously, tourism, as she said, fisheries and agriculture are very important, and it's important that islanders can get things on and off islands, including people and goods. And I just wondered why the islands plan hadn't mentioned ferries within it, considering that they are integral to that particular part of the economy.
Yes, I mean, obviously we have the transport section within the annual report and the objectives within that and commitments that we've made in relation to that too, because you're absolutely right, that connectivity is vital in getting goods and services to islands, as well as for the basics of people accessing healthcare appointments and being able to live their day-to-day lives. But again, issues in relation to that, there's a number of pieces of work that have been ongoing. I talked about the strategic transport projects review, the consultation that's been under. There's also the island's connectivity plan, again, which we're aiming to have the draft of that plan available for consultation towards the end of this year. It'll be the replacement to the ferries plan, but we'll be considering these issues.
It's not a question, convener, but I did meet with the group from Shetland who said that the STPR2 doesn't include a plan for replacement of ferries for their ageing fleet. So it's important to recognise that all these interconnected policy aims are perhaps not connecting.
Absolutely, and I know that that's a point that's been raised by the convener that we said we'd follow up on with transport colleagues.
Thank you. Ariane.
Thanks, convener. I was just waiting for the mic to be turned on. Professor Sindico, you began to speak to this, actually. The Spice briefing talks about the impact of EU exit, but one large impact not mentioned will be the loss of Horizon funding and CapEx infrastructure funding, which has transformed marine infrastructure on islands. And I'd be interested to know what the Scottish Government will do to ensure parity of funding for islands from any new Scottish or UK funding streams.
In terms of a parity of funding, obviously what we have expected and what we had hoped for has been the full replacement of EU funds that have been lost as a result of us no longer being members of the EU. But we haven't seen that fully implemented so far. So, of course, we continue to use our resources as best we can. But I know that this is an example I've raised with the committee before when we look at our Marine Fund Scotland. So we've used that, for example, provides £14 million of funding when that should have been around £62 million that we should have received. So obviously, with full replacement of these funds, we'd be able to do a lot more than what we currently are at the moment.
Thank you.
I move on to questions from Alistair Allen, please.
Thank you, Convener. One of the issues that's of interest to me is workforce dispersal, since I know that that's been raised by the government itself. Obviously, the world, as has been observed, has changed in terms of people's practices around where they work. What can the Scottish Government now do to give individuals the choice to work in an island setting? And particularly I'm thinking of public agencies and the public sector.
I think it's really important that we lead by example in that regard too. But I think that probably the islands team is a perfect example of that. And I think it's since it was established in 2019, we've operated remote and hybrid working. So, and members of the islands team live on our islands too, which I think is really important. I don't know if any of them would want to jump in at that point as well. But we're also setting up a working group to look at workforce dispersal, because I think it is really important that we support people to live and work in our remote rural and island communities as well. We've also seen that through the Crofting Commission, and there have been specific development positions that have been available on our islands. We have our network of ARPID offices too, but we're certainly keen to encourage that and to encourage that hybrid working as well.
And for that hybrid working to make sense in an island setting, obviously not everyone wants to work all week from home. So is part of that solution establishing or finding places where people can hot desk through the week, at least part of the week, so that people aren't stuck in the house all week? So how do we make sure that there are the facilities in island areas to actually do that, and what can we do to work with others to achieve it?
I think that's a really important point and something that we do need to consider, I think, especially now that more people are working. We'd want to encourage more people to embrace hybrid working as well. I don't know if there is a specific strand of work that's ongoing in relation to that at the moment, or if, Erica, do you want to come in?
Thank you. So I do take advantage of the hybrid working option. So I work and live in Orkney and spend some time in the ARPID office in Kirkwall and the rest of the time in my office shed in my garden. So I'm very lucky to be able to do that. And on other occasions, as needed, I'll travel further afield. So that works very well. And we, in the islands team, we are either, I think mostly without exception, either islanders or islanders born who may have left, or island experts. So we're very careful to make sure that we are able to put that lived experience into the work that we do. And through the Islands Bond work, we're looking at options around hubs for other sectors as well, to be able to bring people together under one roof to be able to work in a hybrid way, so that, as you say, not everyone's at home all the time. So we're looking very closely at that.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I think that Alistair's made a good point there about workforce dispersal. If people are going to be working more at home, they need the digital connectivity. So that needs to be... I think I've always said that, you know, working from the outside, coming in, but there's still far too many more remote areas that have not got the connectivity that they need yet to allow everybody to have that opportunity of hybrid working, if that's the option.
To touch on that point now, or if on digital connectivity. I mean, it was really just to completely agree with your point, because I think we've got to have that infrastructure and ensure there's that capability if we want people to live and work and embrace hybrid working too. But that's what I would outline. I mean, through the R100 project, the extra investment that we've put in there to really try and develop and strengthen the digital infrastructure that we have as well. We also have the project where we'd committed to lay 16 subsea cables to improve connectivity, and I believe that those are due to be in place and delivered this year, which obviously will help too. We've been also involved in work on 5G. There's the 4G infill programme as well, where we've been installing more mobile infrastructure that we funded, I think nearly £30 million of investment in 55 non-spot areas, with over half of those masts in place and delivered already. So we understand that there are improvements that need to be made, but we are working hard to deliver that.
I think that's given me the opportunity to highlight a situation in Walsa in Shetland where the subsea cable is going and not everyone on the island will be connected. So there's I have taken that up separately, but it's an issue that demonstrates that not everybody is being reached as anticipated. Alistair?
On that point, given the work that you've described, and there is clearly much more still to be done, but given the work that you've described and given that broadband or the internet is reserved, can you give an indication of roughly the balance of support that's come from the UK and Scottish governments to achieving those things?
Yeah, I'd be happy to come back to the committee with the figures on that in terms of the funding that we've provided, because you're absolutely right, these are reserved areas and we've had to spend over and above to ensure that we are delivering as best we can and reaching either non-spot areas or improving that digital connectivity, because without that extra investment it just wouldn't have been seen as a priority and not rolled out to near the extent that it has been at the moment. But again, I'd be happy to come back to the committee with figures on that.
The questions now from Mercedes.
Hi, morning. Thank you. In the annual report, it mentions plans for a working group to be formed, initially looking at Scottish Government workforce and whether some civil service jobs could be undertaken across any area of Scotland. So I just wondered if you could give us a bit of information about how the working group will be set up and who you envision as having a seat on that group.
Probably have to turn to officials on that. I'm not too sure exactly what stage that work is at, so I don't know who'd like to come in on that. Erica.
Thank you for the question. We're working with our population colleagues on establishing that group, I believe, as part of the action plan that the Cabinet Secretary referenced earlier. But certainly we'd like to involve island voices in that, including members from our Young Islanders Network as well, so that we can really capture from them what it is that they need us to address.
Thanks. I suppose it occurred to me, given that it will be looking specifically at civil service jobs, will there be an invitation to relevant trade unions to sit on that working group, for instance, PCS Scotland?
I'll take that away to my population colleagues who are helping us with that work and certainly put the question to them. Thank you.
We've got a question from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose it's just to pick up on the digital questions that colleagues have asked about already. I'm reading on the Scottish Government's website that the R100 is implementing, I think, £600 million to support the Reach 100 rollout. And we've already talked about like hot desking or hub models, because I know those models are already part of what's happening, not just in the islands, but in other remote and rural areas like in Dumfries and Galloway, for instance. So I suppose my question, Cabinet Secretary, would be that, are you confident that the digital infrastructure that we need will support people to work from home or hub, whether it's part-time or completely from home, as has been described. So I just want to hear about how confident you are that we're going to have rollout for the islands for better connectivity digitally.
We're certainly planning for that to be the case and to ensure as well. I mean, obviously technology is changing all the time and it's really important that whatever infrastructure we put in place is capable of handling any potential, is future-proofed essentially, and can deal with any changes that there may be or upgrades into the future. So I think it's really important that we have made that extra investment, ensuring that we are reaching as many areas as we possibly can, and that's where that extra investment has been absolutely critical.
And just a final wee supplement, and part of that working is with other stakeholders like local authorities, as you've highlighted. And I'm reading about Hebnet, which is a super fast broadband provider for the small islands, Cana, Rum, Egg and Muck. So obviously the Scottish Government will need to work with other stakeholders in order to engage and implement this this rollout as well.
The Member's absolutely right, and I think as we've touched on in previous responses to it, is that collaboration that's critical in terms of many of the policy areas we look at and in terms of many of the objectives that we're looking to implement to and the commitments that we have. So yes, working with our, whether that's our local authority partners, with different operators and with industry is really important.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Moving on now, we've questions from Jenny to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move on to carbon neutral islands, if I may. My colleague Dr. Allen mentioned about the differences in pricing mechanism, and I think the other side of that is the fact that our islands are brilliantly situated to contribute to the blue economy and also renewable energy. So whether it's tidal power, community wind turbines, small hydropower schemes, Iona working on a community heating scheme, and then, of course, the big W1 project off Isle Antairi. So I'd like to just get some information as to how the Scottish Government is working and what they're doing to ensure that islands are supported in their drive to carbon neutrality.
Well, I think I'll probably start off this question. I know that Francesco has been desperate to come in and talk about the Carbon Neutral Islands project, so I wouldn't want to steal his thunder for a moment, and he's been working on this project in some detail. But that's what I think it is. It's a really exciting initiative, actually, and we had increased our commitment. So initially we'd been looking to work with three islands to reach carbon neutrality by 2040, and then increase that to six islands. But I would also want to emphasise that even though the focus is on six islands, that we want to make sure that all islands benefit from this. And it's exciting because, you know, it's our islands that are the forefront of the innovation. And when you see all the work that's happening in renewables right across our islands, we really want to capitalise on the opportunities that are there and work closely with islands in reaching carbon neutrality as well. So we did have an external working group that were looking to identify the different criteria to try and identify which islands we should work with, because I think it's important that we get that mix as well. You'll have some that are quite advanced in the journey in terms of the work that they're undertaking, whereas some that would potentially have a bit further to go. But with that, I'll hand over to Francesco to provide a bit more detail.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you very much for the question. So just a few points. The way I interpret this question is beyond just the Carbon Neutral Island project. It's about these incredible, abundant natural resources and how we can harness them in order to deal with the climate emergency. The key driver and the key principle of the project, of the Carbon Neutral Island project, which is a program for government commitment, is alignment and no duplication with what is already happening. Although we have to learn from other countries, again, we have a lot to share. A lot of good things have happened. Climate emergency is an urgent thing, so we cannot rest on our allures. We have to do things. We have to take action. So first, no duplication. But the second driver and the second principle, if you want, is that it has to be done in a fair and just way. Going net zero can be seen also as a burden, can be seen as an expensive thing. And we need to find the right mix of policies, of governance settings, so that actually this works for all and leaves no one behind. So that's the second driver. The third is that it has to benefit all islands and not just the six that will receive more direct support. Now, when it comes to these resources, the wind energy, the turbines and so forth, let me just go back to your previous question, which I did not have the time to answer. You asked a very important question, which is, okay, learn, you know, listening is fine, but if it's an emergency, at some point you have to stop listening and take action. So let me just, in a few seconds, explain to you how, and to the rest of the committee, how we're planning to do that in the context of the project. So the first thing, once the six islands are announced, will be to work very closely with the communities and not just everybody within the community, all island-related stakeholders, businesses, community, the policymakers, and so forth, the local authorities, obviously. Mm-hmm. And together with island-based organizations, partners who are embedded on the islands, we will develop community-informed climate plans. But you cannot have a plan if you don't know what the emission picture is, if you don't know what actually is happening when it comes to the emissions on Jura, on Isla, on Kolonsay, or wherever you are. And that requires, in some cases, some technical expertise. However, that technical expertise, in some cases, can be done by the community itself, or there can be training so that the community itself can take it on. Because this is not just a one-off. If we do a climate plan or a climate accounting in 2022 and then forget about it until 2040, that's not serious. So this will have to be done in a progressive and continuous way. And that requires resources and it requires time and so forth. Once we have the plan, which is informed by the climate accounting, we'll carry out with the community, obviously, and island-related stakeholders, a climate investment strategy. And that is where, again, working with other areas of government and with other stakeholders will be crucial, because that's where the action will start. But action requires funding, but not only public funding. Public funding is one of the three streams that we're thinking. Net zero anywhere in the world cannot require just public funding. There's no country in the world that can do that, no island in the world that can probably do that. So the example of Kolonsay becomes very relevant, promoting public-private partnership. There are plenty of examples out there in Europe, again, where in transport, in energy, or in housing, you have this public-private partnership. These things don't just happen. You have to nurture them. You have to learn about the good practices elsewhere. And the third is driving private investment. We have an incredible... We mentioned innovation on the islands. Innovation is not just about how to harness renewables. It's how to harness it in a way that drives profit, but also that so that profit goes back into the community. That was the clear example of community renewables and so forth. There's such a landscape of initiatives already there, of climate hubs that are coming up, that the Carbon Neutral Island Project will leverage and will garner together and will provide that platform for the islands and the island communities.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I was on Isla at the weekend and I visited one of the distilleries, Beaumont Distillery, and I know the others on the island are also following plans, and I spent a good couple of hours with the distillery manager who was telling me about the increase of his time that is actually spent on greening the process. So they've looked at transportation, they've looked at water usage and power consumption, and they're currently looking at trying to improve the heating in the swimming pool, which is adjacent to them. So there's lots of projects going on. Whisky, really important industry to Scotland and contributes billions to the UK Treasury. So I'm interested to know what engagement the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government to ensure that areas like Isla get the appropriate investment to support that this really important immediate work that they're doing to reduce the carbon footprints.
Well, yeah, and I think initially I'd probably touch on a point that Francesco had made about the importance of the partnerships in that regard. And you're absolutely right. I think there's a lot of exciting work happening in Isla at the moment. Mm-hmm. And I think especially with these critical industries that do have, I think also when they're looking at their own sustainability and the impact that that has right through their supply chain as well, I think that they are showing a positive lead in terms of the work that they're taking, and I think ensuring that we work with them is critical, and again ensuring that we're not duplicating anything that's taken place, but how we can really support that work to happen as well is really important.
Just to highlight as well that obviously we're fully aware of this, there are growth deals out there. Obviously, we mention often the Islands growth deal, but you also have an Argyll and Bute growth deal, which focuses also on Isla. And this is co-financing between Scottish Government and UK Government. And just to finish up, I mean, distilleries, but also other areas. You mentioned the swimming pool. You know, this is about co-benefits. We obviously want to deal with the climate emergency for the climate, but not just because of the climate, because net zero done well will provide energy, will provide means to tackle fuel poverty, which is what we were discussing before. It will provide those community benefits, which will make a net zero island more attractive. So also the repopulation in a way brings back to that. I just wanted to highlight that.
Will the announcement of the six carbon neutral islands be soon? Like 6 months, year, 2 years?
It will be soon. Obviously, I won't be making any announcements today, and you'll understand why the government hasn't made any announcements over the previous weeks in the run-up to the local election campaign, but it will be made soon.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Edward, please?
Thank you, Convener. I remember watching this bill come through this committee at Stage 1 and Stage 2 and in the Parliament at Stage 3, and one of the criticisms that was raised, well, questions that was raised, was whether island impact assessments would be worthwhile and carried out properly or would come as a tick box exercise. So, looking at the reasons, and I think the professor said that there was multifaceted reasons for population decline, but I would suggest that connectivity, health, education and quality of life is what keeps people on the island. Let's look at health to start with. Mental health issues can be a real problem in rural areas, and islands don't necessarily have mental health experts. And so they have to be brought into the islands, and they don't always make it because the ferries aren't there, or there is no ferries available, or the weather. So my question to you, Cabinet Secretary, is on health. Are you aware of how many island impact assessments have been carried out in relation to the changes of health provision on the islands in the last year?
I don't have figures on that. I don't know if the team would be able to answer that, but I'd be happy to come back to the committee with more information.
Okay. So, I mean, my question is that we know, for example, I think when we went, I think it was to Shetland, indeed, is that people travelled up for, or it could have been Orkney, but the mental health professionals travelled up on a Tuesday, and that didn't always happen on a Tuesday, and sometimes there were 2 or 3 weeks delays, and that really is a serious issue, and I'm not aware of the health boards carrying out impact assessments for the failure to provide health care, and I would be helpful to have that. So my next question is a little bit more parochial, if I may. RASE, for an example, relies on the goodwill of CalMac to deliver parcels out. They're dropped off at the terminal and dropped onto the island when the ferry comes over. CalMac are stopping that service because they say it costs £250,000 a year to run. I'm not sure where they got that figure from. A man in a white van or a lady in a white van wouldn't cost £250,000 to run, but to get Amazon parcels or not to get the shopping over delivered over to RASE is a real problem. It happens on other islands, and CalMac are being very iffy about it. And I've looked at their impact assessment, and it brings my greatest fear that it is a tick box exercise that cannot be justified. So are you convinced, on a more general point, Cabinet Secretary, that island impact assessments for change of services are being done properly? And if you're unable to give an answer, could you have it look at a few and respond to the committee to confirm that they are? Because I fear they're not.
Yes, and absolutely. I mean, we certainly don't want island community impacts assessments to be a tick box exercise, because I think it would really defeat the purpose of why they were introduced in the first place as well. But I think if there are any particular examples, just such as the one that you've raised, or any other members are aware of, then please do write to me and raise them, and I'm more than happy to look at those in more detail. I don't have the detail of that community impact assessment, so I'm not able to give a view on that today, but I'd be more than happy to follow that up with the community with you as well. I do know that there is the option there as well for local authorities to ask for a review of an island's community impact assessment too, so that option is available. But again, happy to look at these specific examples.
Convener, thank you. Just to say, those would demonstrate the fact that I believe that they are becoming tick box exercises, and I believe that it's a failure of this legislation to make sure that they're being done. And I would like to see in the report some confirmation from the Cabinet Secretary in future that island impact assessments are being carried out with the spirit that they were implemented in and under the legislation. Thank you, Convener.
Can I move on to questions from Mercedes?
Thank you. Yes, a couple about the strategic objective 3, which I think is the transport, improving transport services. So the Scottish Government have committed to engaging with local authorities and island communities in developing regulations and guidance for the bus services provisions under the Transport Act, which, you know, as the Cabinet Secretary will be well aware, the Act gives local authorities power to bring buses into municipal ownership. But given the geographical challenges on the islands and issues around passenger demand, I was wondering if you could tell us what additional support the Scottish Government plans to provide in order that local authorities can deliver publicly run bus services should they wish to.
I mean, I do know that the bus provisions had been delayed because of the pandemic and because of ongoing work with Brexit as well. And yeah, we're due to engage with local authorities and with communities on that too. But I'd be happy to take that away and look at that issue in particular.
Okay.
And see what more support we can provide in that regard.
Okay, thank you very much. And then with regards to the connectivity plan, I'm not sure if... Is that going to be published by the end of this year?
Yes, that's the intention, that the draft plan would be published by the end of this year and available for consultation at that point.
And are you able to give a commitment that ferry services will remain in public ownership as part of that connectivity plan?
As a government, we've already given that commitment anyway.
Okay.
So I'm happy to provide that assurance again today.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. And then... I don't know if I've got time to ask one on housing as well, strategic objective 4. I was just wondering what recent assessment the Scottish Government's made of private rent levels on the islands and whether rents are higher or lower on average than compared to the national statistics.
I mean, I do know that in terms of finding affordable housing, that is an increasing issue for people that live in our island communities. I don't know whether officials here today would have any further information on that. But again, that's something I'd be happy to raise with my Cabinet colleagues and get back to the member of the committee with further information and more detail on that. I don't have the figures in front of me today, but Erica...
We don't have those figures, but Nicola and I can work together on the next iteration of the island survey to make sure that we capture or include some work around that, and we'll do that in collaboration with our housing colleagues and report back.
Okay. And I was wondering, just related to that, what work has there been to explore whether a rent freeze for social and council tenants could be implemented on the islands? I don't know if the Scottish Government has spoken to local authorities on islands about that.
I don't think, no, the islands team won't have done that. I would have to check with housing colleagues to see if that's something or a piece of work that they've undertaken.
And have you looked at all at how a rent freeze might benefit private tenants on islands?
Again, that's something we'd have to check with housing policy.
Okay, thank you very much. Cheers.
Thank you. We have a question from Emma, and just for the record, Emma's no longer substitute as Jim has returned to the meeting. But a question from Emma. And the screen appears to have frozen. Okay, can we move on then? We have a question from Karen. If we can come back to Emma, we will.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask, in terms of the rollout of the £30 million Islands programme, can you unpack the nature of the projects and also touch upon the partnership work that's underway, specifically how the Scottish Futures Trust will support the Scottish Government in the delivery of the programme?
We'd committed to £30 million worth of investment over the course of 5 years. So we delivered the first part of that last year. That was about £9.5 million worth of funding investment. And last year, the programme worked over three different strands. So we had the Infrastructure Investment Fund, the Communities Fund, which communities themselves could look to bid into. And there were grants available of up to £150,000 available through that as well. and we also had the Healthy Islands Fund too. So that was just over £1 million worth of funding to really look at projects that would help support the health and well-being of people on our islands. And we've obviously taken some of the learning from that, listened to our local authorities colleagues in terms of looking at shaping what the programme will look like this year. So obviously I was at committee for the budget session at the start of the year this year, where we announced £4 million worth of funding for the programme this year. And this year it will be different, and it will be done on the basis of competitive bids to the fund. And again, that's based on feedback that we'd received previously. And in terms of some of the projects, I said a bit about the work that had been done in Kerraran, the impact that we'd seen there as well. And in terms of the infrastructure fund, there's also the money that we've committed to the Fair Isle Bird Observatory too, and the rest of the funding available as part of that was allocated to the different island authorities. But I don't know if anybody would want to come in terms of some of the other projects that we've seen feed through the different strands of the fund. Nicola?
Sorry. Thank you. Yes, as Cabinet Secretary said, we've had numerous projects that have came through last year, and it's probably useful to note that we launched this year's on the 21st of March, and it'll be run as a competitive process moving forward. It was very successful, we felt, the last year's one. There was numerous community projects, and it was very much community-focused and at community level for both the Healthy Islands Fund and the Islands Communities Fund. And moving forward, we're hoping still to be able to work with our local authorities as lead applicants, whilst having bids from communities coming in. And on your point about the Scottish Futures Trust, they're in with their expertise to manage the fund for us, and also the relationships with us and our local authorities to bring those together, whilst also making sure that we leverage funding from other areas of government that they have expertise with, to make sure we get best value for the money that we have and the money that we're able to source from other areas. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask, will the annual report be a guide for future fiscal decisions?
Yeah, well, I think it's really important that we take the learning as we go through, you know, from the previous rounds of funding that we've had, as well as looking at the annual report. So I do think, yeah, that does feed into how we will be looking to shape funds going into the future too. And sorry, Nicola.
Thank you. It's also just useful to note that we are running it by our National Islands Plan Delivery Group and Rail and Strategic Group that will support us with any funding decisions that we're making going forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think we've got Emma back, so we have a question from Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Apologies, I think internet dropped off there. It's just a question about the impact of COVID on the progress towards meeting the 13 strategic objectives, because we can't forget that we've just had 2.5 years pandemic that's impacted probably everybody's lives. So, and just to pick on the point that Edward Mountain made about seeing mental health professionals, for instance, I know that when we took evidence at Health Committee that digital connectivity did support engagement in the mental health aspect, although, you know, we can't forget the importance of face-to-face appointments as well. But I'm just, Cabinet Secretary, wondering, how has COVID-19 impacted island communities and the progress towards meeting the 13 strategic objectives in the plan?
Well, I think it undoubtedly has had an impact. Obviously, resource had to completely pivot to help try and deal with the pandemic as well as with EU exit as well. But that's where I do think that even in spite of that, I think that you can see from the annual report that, you know, some actions have been completed, but also we have made good progress in, I would say, right across the piece when it comes to the strategic objectives. So while some particular pieces of work either had to be put on hold or had to be delayed because of the pandemic, I think in spite of that, we've managed to make really good progress across all of these different areas too. And I think as well, I mean, just coming back to the point that the member had raised on healthcare as well, I think it's, you know, through the pandemic, like in a lot of other areas, we saw these innovations that we've been able to see rolled out. I think the NHS Near Me, I think, has been a particular success in relation to that, which has been rolled out across all health board areas as well. And there have also been some other developments in relation relation to our healthcare too. I think in relation to diabetes, for example, a test of change pilot has been rolled out as well throughout this period. So, I do think that we have been fairly successful, I think, in working across the objectives, despite the undoubted impact that the pandemic has had.
Does there need to be a slight revision or any slight renewal of the plan to acknowledge the COVID pandemic? Because the plan was launched 12 weeks before the pandemic, as you mentioned in your opening statement. So just so that people are aware that, yes, there's been an impact, but progress has been made in certain areas. But does that need to be tweaked at all?
Well, I think that's where the implementation of it and the monitoring of the plan is really important as well. So I touched on a response earlier about the route map that we'd be setting out, looking at the detailed actions that we'll be taking in relation to each of the commitments. So that will be publishing shortly as well. And I know we've also talked about the Island Strategic Forum. We have the National Islands Plan Delivery Group as well, who will be continuing to monitor that and to ensure that we are dealing with the challenges as they're being experienced by our island communities. So I think by continuing that collaboration, getting that feedback, I think that what we have set out in the plan and the actions that we're taking going forward will be relevant, because the route map as well will be a living document, so that will have to change. And we can see that every day just now. We see with the cost of living in terms of fuel poverty, the different challenges that can be thrown at us at the last minute. So I think it's important that we have a plan that can adapt to that and adjust to it as necessary. And Nicola, I think, would like to come in with another point.
Thank you, and thank you for your question. It was also just to point out that in 2020, we also undertook a National Islands Plan through a COVID lens survey with our local authorities, which asked them to identify any key strategic objectives that they thought were particularly relevant in light of COVID. And we were quite reassured by that the plan was still relevant at that time.
Thank you. I'm conscious that we've reached our allocated time, but Jim Fairley does have a question he would like to put to you.
My apologies. I feel like I'm gatecrashing one party coming in and going out again. It's a technical question, I think, for Professor Francesco. Alistair Allen alluded to earlier on about the connection charges for getting island communities connected to the grid. It costs more to actually connect from an island than it does mainland or down south. Is there an opportunity, given the renewable capability of the island communities, is there an opportunity to do something like what they've done at Egg to create community energy systems that don't require us to have permission from anybody else to connect, to actually allow the islands to take advantage of their own natural resources without being constrained?
Yes. The opportunity is definitely out there, especially for the so-called off-grid islands. So you mentioned Egg, you have the likes of Fula, of Fair Isle. There are a number of, especially the smaller, if you want, islands that either are already experiencing it or that are looking at it very closely, especially through the support of CARES. When it comes to a slightly bigger island, the technology probably will get there quite soon. Again, it's a question of governance. It's a question of governance, the Ofgem situation, and so forth. I think I'll leave it to that, but I'm happy to take it back also to our colleagues within government that deal with these more energy and the regulatory side. But in short, the opportunity is definitely there. Some communities are looking at it very closely, are looking at examples from Egg and so forth. But it's a bit like the Faro situation. It's a complex landscape and.
Can I ask one very brief, I promise it's very brief again, it's directed to you, Francesco. We've got wind, tidal, we've got all these renewable energies. What role do you see energy from waste playing in our future ability to be net zero?
Everything counts. So what I mean by that is that obviously biomass and the circular economy and energy coming from the use of waste needs to be looked at. So, for example, one of the activities in the Carbon Neutral Island Project has been a scoping exercise to look at projects elsewhere. And again, and I promise we don't only look at the Faroe Islands, but this came from the Faroe Islands. It was a very interesting project where again, public-private partnership, the salmon industry in the island, and the waste coming from the salmon industry was providing energy and heat to a certain number of houses in Tórshavn, the capital of the Faroe Islands. So definitely there's a scope for that as well.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and officials for joining us this morning and for the helpful advice provided. And we'll now have a short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave. I suspend the meeting.
Just convene them, I'll just read best.
Our third item of business today is consideration of the Official Controls Transitional Staging Period Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2022 SSI 2022/90. This instrument has been made using powers under the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. The process for consideration of instruments laid under the European Union Withdrawal Act consists of two parts. First, the committee must agree whether it's content that the parliamentary procedure designated to the instrument by the Scottish Government is appropriate, and I refer members to paper 3 from page 14 of your briefing pack. The Scottish Government has designated the negative procedure for this SSI. Are members content that the negative parliamentary procedure designated to the instrument by the Scottish Government is appropriate? Please raise your hand or type an R in the chat box if participating remotely. No comments? Mercedes? No. Okay. Turning now to the policy of the instrument. Does any member have any comments on the instrument? Please raise your hand or type an R in the chat box if participating remotely. No. Members will have seen the proposal set out on page 17 of the members' pack. Are members content to write to the Scottish Government to ask why the Scottish Government considers it necessary to introduce this exemption, which, unless the transitional staging period is extended for a fourth time, would only be in place for approximately 6 weeks between 12th May and 30th June 2022, and for an update regarding the transitional staging period beyond 30th June 2022. Rachel?
Content with that, convener. However, can we make it specific that we ask the government what the impact is of the exemption? It says why the Scottish Government feels it necessary to introduce exemption, but what would be the exemption, the impact if the exemption wasn't there?
Yep, we can do that.
Thank you.
If there are no other comments, that concludes our business in public, and we might now move into private session.